So welcome, everyone, this evening. My name is Daniel Barber. I'm the Thomas A. and Curry C. Barron Visiting Professor in the Environment and Humanities at the Princeton Environmental Institute, hosted here in the School of Architecture for this year position. I'm at Princeton on leave from the School of Design at the University of Pennsylvania. Hi, Penn colleagues, great to have you here. And it's a great pleasure to welcome you to After the Spectacular Image, Art, Architecture, and the Media of Climate Change Symposium, sponsored by the PEI, co-sponsored by the School of Architecture, the Princeton Mellon Initiative in Architecture, Urbanism, and the Humanities, and the Program on Media and Modernity. So a nice sort of collection of interlocutors here today. As a visiting professor, it's been a really great opportunity to have the chance to develop this symposium. I'm very grateful to the PEI and to the Barron family for supporting both this visiting position as it continues and of course, the events this evening and tomorrow. The Institute and the Barron's dedication to humanistic frameworks for engaging environmental pressures represent a bold positioning of these debates within the Princeton scholarly community and at large, and it's really been a pleasure to have a chance to participate in that initiative. So I want to begin thanking the PEI and the Barron family, of course, and a few other people that have been very instrumental to making this evening and tomorrow happen. Kathy Hackett, Laura Matecha, Holly Wells, Raj Trotsky, and Igor Heifetz, all at the PEI, have been incredible support in organizing things and sort of keeping everything in line. So thank you to all of them. Also to Francois Morel, the director at the PEI, Mario Gendelsonis and Monica Ponce de Leon, the interim and new dean of the School of Architecture, for their support, and Stan Allen, the previous interim dean, for his assistance as I was working towards this position, and many others here at the School of Architecture that have been helpful in talking through some of these ideas. I also want to thank my friends and colleagues, Irene Chang, Al Narath, Rafiko Ruiz, and Orit Halpern, who will be here a bit later this evening, for their initial feedback on the symposium themes and some of the ideas of working through some of those details as we were moving along. And of course, thanking the presenters and the moderators, not only for participating, but also for the discussions a number of us had along the way that were very helpful. So I want to just take a few brief minutes to both introduce the sort of logistics of the next sort of 24 hours, and also very generally some of the conceptual frameworks in which we'll be operating. I've intentionally taken a very light hand on sort of curatorial terms in bringing these participants in this material together in order to solicit participation from a range of different sort of perspectives on a set of interesting topics, as I'll play out in just a moment. But the framework for the proceedings is really intended to encourage discussion and intercommunication, so all of you are sort of implicated as well, right? As we proceed through this evening and tomorrow, each of the speakers will make a half an hour presentation, and we'll have 30 minutes discussion at each panel, and then we'll also have a closing discussion at the end of the afternoon tomorrow. So lots of opportunities to sort of talk through some of these issues as we proceed. So please join us and dive in. And I just also want to note what's not on this schedule, just in terms of a quick sort of logistics issue. Breakfast will be served from 8:30 in the morning, so you can kind of mentally slip that in. And both breakfast and lunch are available for the audience as well. So again, more opportunities for discussion, and please join us. Okay, so before diving in and beginning the first panel, I just want to spend a few brief moments framing some of these general themes that will allow us to proceed. And I'm just going to make three sort of general considerations that, you know, I should say the presenters have not been obligated to address in any direct way, but that I hope might help us to sort of think through some of their presentations and the discussions that follow. The first sort of point to make here is to propose that, generally speaking, we understand climate largely through images, right? And this is sort of based through on a general premise, of course, that we're all encountering in various ways, according to our sort of professional and personal selves, the various challenges of climate change and associated environmental pressures. And while we have a sort of physiological and many other forms of experience of the weather, climate is something that we do not immediately experience, of course, right? But that requires a sort of broader knowledge of global and regional systems that requires mediation, right? That requires some form of expressive, technical, or speculative image, or some combination therein. There is, of course, a history to this image economy, some aspects of which we'll see over the next 24 hours, a history that importantly disrupts some familiar narratives and invokes new methods for the analysis of representational strategies and forms of cultural production. So the encounter with the contemporary social, ecological, and political pressures that we've collectively sort of grouped under this term climate change, right, which of course has many different aspects to it, solicits these new images as part of what I want to sort of put on the table, as well as new methods, new forms of analysis to understand them, right? Okay, so that's the first sort of general framework that we need images to sort of understand climate. Of course, here, a relatively early example. The second framework I want to foreground is that the relatively unspectacular nature of this image economy, generally speaking, presents obstacles to effective collective action and complicates the political resonance of these image effects, right? Which is to say that in a spectacle and media-infused culture, it can be difficult to see the slow and agglomerative changes characteristic of the climate system and the sociobiotic disruptions that these changes lead to. As Rob Nixon, who's not here yet, I don't think, has recently put it, quote, slowly unfolding environmental catastrophes present formidable representational obstacles that can hinder our efforts to mobilize and act decisively, unquote. So we're faced with technical challenges in image production, as in here, sort of monumental methane leak in Los Angeles, only visible through certain imaging technologies, as well as challenges in conceptualizing new relationships between representation and knowledge, between theory and practice, between data and agency, as humanistic discourses increasingly examine the contours of social and cultural change relative to the unpredictability of our environmental future, right? So that second point that these images are forced to engage a number of things that are sort of hard to see, right? And this presents some challenges both for image production and analysis. The final point that I want to make is that cultural fields, such as art, architecture, and media production, and certainly many others, have increasingly since World War II become sites for the articulation and elaboration of these image economies, right? And for examining the resonance of environmental knowledge across broader social and cultural patterns. So an early sort of instant, well, not so early necessarily, but a sort of mid-50s instance of this, just sort of, well, a stone's throw away if you've got a really strong arm, at the Princeton and Architectural Laboratory, about to become the Center for Embodied Computing, I think, if I have that right, but which has been around since the mid-50s as a sort of site for experiments in architectural and climate methods. So as discursive sites, creative fields have increasingly engaged in the production of images of climate, both as a means to share knowledge internal to their disciplines, and also as a means to integrate knowledge from other fields to operate through these creative practices on the sort of resonance and complications introduced by this increased knowledge of the global ecological system. So in sum, over the past century at least, image making and visualization practices in the arts and literature and in the sciences have formed a cultural infrastructure focused on the relationship between humans, other species, and their environments. These images have, in numerous ways, impacted political and cultural debates around nature, environment, and climate, and will continue to do so. The presentations gathered today and tomorrow continue a focused inquiry into the contours of these broad debates and the methodological challenges they present, and I'm sure that you join me in looking forward to hearing them all. Okay, so that's a very sort of rough set of general general sort of frameworks that, again, you know, we can continue to return to as appropriate in the questions and so on. My last task this afternoon is to introduce the moderator of the first panel. Carl Kessero is the curator of American art here at the Princeton Art Museum and the co-curator with Alan Braddock of the forthcoming traveling exhibition called Nature's Nation, American Art and Environment, very pertinent, of course, to the themes we're playing out today. And Alan Braddock, his co-conspirator here, it's worth mentioning, will be the Barron visiting professor next year, right? So a nice kind of chain of continuity relative to some of these themes. So welcome to Carl, and welcome to you all. Thanks for coming.
you've thanked everyone, so let me be the first to thank you for putting together this symposium, which I certainly, and I know we all are looking forward to, and for allowing me to participate. I'll just dive right in. I just actually met just now our first speaker, who is Catherine Yusoff, who comes to us from London, where she's a senior lecturer in the School of Geography at Queen Mary University of London. Her work has focused on political aesthetics, social theory, and abrupt environmental change, particularly how dynamic Earth events impact social thought. Catherine's current research addresses questions of what she termed geologic life within the proposed geologic epoch of the Anthropocene. She is interested in how non-human and non-organic dimensions of life have consequences for how we understand issues of fossil fuels, human-Earth relations, and materiality in the politics of life. And she is interested in the opportunities the Anthropocene presents for rethinking the interactions between the earth sciences and human geography in the geosocial formations of anthropogenic change. Her talk today is on Geomorphic Aesthetics, A New Epoch of Thought and the Anthropocene. Catherine.
Introduction, and thank you for the invitation. It's a great privilege to be here. I only just got off a plane about an hour and a half ago, so I might be doing a little bit of my own time traveling within this talk. So what I want to just begin with is kind of a brief genealogy of global images. So I want to kind of situate climate change within a kind of production of global world space, and then to kind of move, hopefully not too abruptly, into some cave art, and hopefully the connections will become apparent. This is just kind of a sort of part of the backstory that I hope will kind of inform some of the connections that I want to make later on between climate change and the Anthropocene, and to see the kind of shifts between the two. So I'm interested in the production of global world image space, and I say global world image space and it's a bit of a mouthful, just to kind of highlight the fact that global visions are produced from somewhere. So these are located visions that are situated within modes of production, technologies of reproduction, and this kind of material, political, and technical geographies of the globe constitute its located vision. So that's kind of within this heterogeneous space of other worldlings, other ways of seeing and being in the world. So the kind of architectures of global world space began in earnest in the 20th century, but the desire at stake for this kind of real-time globality was evident in the colonial networks of coal, telecommunication, and transport within the British Empire, particularly during industrialization. And these are the kind of streams of coal going out from the UK. So these architectures of globalizing space culminate in the International Geophysical Year in 1957 to 58. And this is alongside the launch of Sputnik and other ballistic missiles. So it's kind of, it's global world space as kind of war space and within the kind of geopolitical context of global war and then Cold War. So the earth sciences become very implicated in being one of the main recipients of funding for projects of globality, but also the kind of producers of these new spatial and visual technologies. So images of the globe from space and the kind of vertical architectures that were aimed for during the Cold War become kind of translated into the general circulation models and the kind of God's eye views that we get in these global circulation models of climate change. So at technical level, the kind of campaign is against the weather, always attempting to obtain mastery, as in kind of with rocketry, over the various powers of weather to kind of cloud this line of sight. So even before the kind of images from space, the Luna 3 probe, and the ability to picture the Earth, there's a kind of coterminous emergence with the ability to control space with rocketry. So crucial to this development of rocketry was the establishment of accurate weather stations and these reporting systems that involve the strategic positioning of weather stations on the ground, particularly between the poles, to both detect and measure changes in Cold War atmosphere. So literally measuring the weather to measure the possibility or detect rocketry. So most notably, the US established at the South Pole what they called Weather Central on the Antarctic axis. And this formed this kind of terminal link from pole to pole, linking these chains of weather stations that were running through three meridians to encircle the whole Earth. So it wasn't quite as sort of dramatic as the Sputnik production of space, but it was very much a kind of colonization on the ground. But what was important about these kind of bipolar measurements was that they achieved the first synoptic measurements of the world's weather. So they created a co-present image of weather that allowed the construction of climate as a kind of globalized system of data exchange. So this was the first global meteorological model of climate circulation. And it's the kind of legacy and baseline data for contemporary anthropogenic climate change and ozone depletion. But climate change introduces a kind of unexpected fracture into this project of universalizing architectures, and it ruptures these neat enclosures of whole Earth, both in kind of representational terms and social political terms. So just as the kind of world's spaces are nearly mapped, they're nearly kind of completed as a global project of data exchange, there's a kind of shock into the imagination of the veracity of these Earth systems and the kind of interpolation of humans within those systems. So broadly, there's a kind of shift from technologies of control to trying to find a way to adequately image and imagine these excess of greenhouse gases within the constraints of current models, as well as kind of acknowledging the long-term climate change and what that means for a kind of history of life on Earth. So what kind of, you know, when human life becomes subject to actually quite dynamic climate change, that also shifts our kind of positioning or the positioning of the human within a kind of geologic time frame. So climate change becomes representative in a double sense of representing practices and ontological arrangements of the kind of unintended global side effects of these kind of totalizing Western visions of the world and their inability to deal with material and representative excess of closed world systems. So there's a kind of parallel between the representational project and the kind of impacts on the ground. It also demonstrated how world resources had been mobilized for Western growth, whereas entropy or waste was being exported in both into the atmosphere, but also into various kind of colonial sacrifice zones. So it's kind of into this scene of representational failure in which climate change models really struggle to compete with the changes already at work in the world. So climate change models found it very difficult to actually keep up with climate changes in the world. So often the predictions, even though they were future predictions, were often kind of, you know, still behind what was actually happening in the world. So more data didn't necessarily translate into a kind of more effective representational model. And then with the Anthropocene, you get this new kind of introduction of spaces, of the kind of subterranean spaces, as a space of a new project of understanding and representation. So, this kind of claim of a kind of epochal shift that's at work in the Anthropocene, a geologic turn, it makes this intervention into the space of the kind of representative space of climate change, but it also suggests something new. Perhaps a new epoch of thought and a need to rematerialize, reontologize, and actually geologize humanity. So rather than anthropomorphizing humanity, the actual kind of, it introduces the thought of humans as geologic agents. So while climate change modeling enacted this transformation of the representative scale from human environmental relations, it didn't represent a change in kind in this kind of modernist narrative or drive towards a totality of world image. And I think the Anthropocene introduces this fracture into thought. So thinking with strata, or thinking with geotrauma, as we might call it, on the other hand, might be a kind of provocation to think about how the Earth stratifies thought, bodies, disciplines. So I want to think about how the Anthropocene poses geologic time as this kind of inhuman milieu that is both before and after us as geologic prehistory. So this kind of notion of a replacing of the human into prehistory. This is from this fantastic museum in Denmark, and it has all the kind of lineage of hominids, and it ends up with Stephen Hawking's, which is a really curious curatorial decision, which I'd like to know more about, of this kind of, and it's called Meet the Family, which is very, very interesting in this kind of figuration of the genealogy of the human. So geology also becomes compositional to this era, so a way of thinking about the organization of social formations as kind of intractably located within geologic materials, particularly fossil fuels. So we can begin to think about the role of these geologic materials in social worlds and in bodies. Alongside these kind of grand claims about planetary mastery and geologic wasting powers, I think there's a need to kind of begin again as a geologically informed subject to think about how geology penetrates social formations and bodies and incites all sorts of connections with the Earth, very material but also kind of ontological connections with the Earth. So we might think about a geologically informed subject, but also perhaps a geologically deformed subject if we take on board the various destratifying powers that are being enacted on the atmosphere, the ocean, and the strata. So, you know, we can think about the Anthropocene as much about destratification as a kind of stratification of a layer of sort of human extinction, which is often kind of the image that is portrayed of the Anthropocene. So if we think about kind of the Anthropocene as a concept and a material claim to the strata, it's not yet been designated as an epoch. So this is the Time Lords of the Stratigraphic Committee who will be deciding later this year whether to approve the Anthropocene as an epochal claim. But it does name this kind of thought image of a thresholding from the Holocene, from a kind of stable environmental context to much more changed relationship with the Earth. And this promises a rethinking of the entanglement of humans within the world at material and ontological level. So I'm interested in holding to this epochal claim. What does that mean in terms of our thinking about world relations and kind of the role of kind of the human within the Earth as a dynamic force that the Anthropocene kind of names? If we think about it as an epochal claim, a shift in the kind of prescriptive life of the human, then we also need to think about it as a destruction of all the things that are tied to that Holocene humanism. So that would include the kind of late liberal forms of subjectivity, forms of life that are tied and live through fossil fuels, such as my excessive burning to get here today, of my own particular signature on climate change, but also is, you know, to actually raise the question of whether humanism is adequately kind of enabled to deal with a kind of with thinking about a geologic condition. And then, of course, there's sort of capitalism that's tied to the production of kind of neoliberal kind of subjectivity. So if we think about it as an epoch moment, we also need to think about the things that are tied to the Holocene that may potentially be kind of, you know, being reconfigured in the Anthropocene. So one story we could have of the rocks is this kind of narrative of what I call anthropogenesis, the kind of Anthropocene conceived as a new origin story about the beginnings and endings of man, that's kind of recast through a geologic lens. So that's kind of one approach. Often this is the story of a kind of fallen master subject with these kind of Promethean powers that somehow needs to reverse the petrifying hold of the kind of strata on the human species. And this is often proposed through kind of technological innovation or eco-modernism. So this is a kind of genesis that names man as the originator of a new geologic force operating at the scale of the planet. But geologic change doesn't begin and end with man. Even if we look at this kind of mapping of population onto coal, you can see this kind of very close correlation between the explosive material effects of fossil fuels and changes in the kind of the body of the human. So if we think about the human as constituted through this kind of subsidy from the Carboniferous, then we begin to change our understanding about the kind of agency and direction of life and the way in which geology works within the contours of our social and political life. And at this point, there's a kind of ontological reconfiguration that may be kind of considered, and to think about the human as subtended by geology. So it's actually kind of something that is kind of emergent out of a geologic relation. So as such, the Anthropocene presents this kind of new arrangement or geographical imagination of the Earth, which includes the materiality of contemporary subjectivity, its ecologies, and new discourses on time and history. So this is a kind of new coding of the Earth that's instigated by the imagination and actuality of climate change. But in the concept of the Anthropocene, there's a kind of return to the Earth as a territory of differentiation. And I really love this image because it's like the arteries of fossil fuels over the states through the pipelines. So we can begin to think about these infrastructures as a kind of a bodily ecology of the Anthropocene. But what is this new Earth, if we're at a threshold moment, what is this new Earth like? How is this Anthropocene globalism different from other forms of historic global imaginations that form this kind of trajectory from colonial to neocolonial to neoliberal kind of forms of subjectivity? We could perhaps argue that if the Anthropocene is to be truly epochal moment, so if things ought to look a bit different, that there ought to be some kind of fracture in the continuation of those kind of dominant models of imagining and our relations to the Earth. And this kind of, what I think of as this sort of Ozymandias meets Charlton Heston moment of kind of monumentalizing man and kind of man contemplating the ruins of man, or this kind of notion of man v nature. I kind of prefer this man as nature, back to Charlton Heston again. But this monumentalizing is clearly kind of what geology does. It needs a kind of the discipline of geology. Monuments, fossil monuments, are proper to that discipline. But in the humanities too, we've had this kind of burgeoning flurry of monumentalizing Anthropocene statements. And there's a kind of need, I think, to question the notion of monumentalizing in the Anthropocene, because it's a very gendered and culturally exclusive practice, but it also kind of fixes, it has a fossilizing effect. It's fossil making, rather than sort of paying attention to these kind of slow violences that were mentioned before of the Anthropocene in the making as an active kind of practice in the world. So if the Anthropocene names this kind of break in the understanding of time and a geologic epoch out of the Holocene into the Anthropocene, It's also a kind of material cut in bodies, actual specific vulnerable bodies, bodies of Earth, bodies of non-human organisms, social and geologic bodies. So in understanding ourselves as a geologic force, there's a need to understand geology as this substratum to life. Something that underpins the possibilities of life is duration, and something like a kind of precondition of life that pertains to conditions of survival, of life itself, but also beyond life. So implicit in the Anthropocene thesis is this call to begin again as a geologic subject. But if humans have acquired this geologic force or powers, what kind of geologic subject is born in this moment? What are the identity politics of this scene? Who are the major powers and the minor subjects? What risks and precarities are involved in the constraints of territory and the material destratifications that are being enacted by climate change? And we see this kind of very, very clearly around in the kind of political scene of the world today, is this kind of crash between material destratifications and the hardening of kind of territorial borders. And these two things coming together, these kind of geosocial formations, are part of the kind of the sort of political scene of the Anthropocene. So rather than looking at kind of future apocalypse, what I want to do in the last sort of 10 minutes, it's about 10 minutes? Yep, it's really sort of peer into the underground. So we're going back to cave art now as a way to try and think some of these interactions with what I've been calling geologic life. So what I'm interested in here is how the aesthetics of a cave are both a kind of phenomena of experience and a kind of phantasma, a kind of more than experience, because they kind of offer the possibility of having an untimely conversation around geology. Okay, so the fact that cave art is even kind of representationally intelligible to us is a kind of communication with geologic time. It's a communication with a kind of image making and identity formation that perhaps happened 40,000 years ago, and iterative stages in between. So these are incommensurable moments. They're kind of moments that are not meant to touch between 40,000 years ago and now. But in the act of looking, there's a way in which these kind of images erupt as a kind of sensible comprehension, in which this kind of, you can see an act of witnessing identity in the making, in the same way that I think that there's a lot of discourse around kind of the human at the moment in terms of the Anthropocene and this notion of a kind of another moment of a new kind of identity, a new geologic identity for the human. So the first kind of geologic subject that I want to talk about is, just very quickly, is the Birdman from the Lascaux cave. And this is kind of an experimental actualization of how one form passes by another in the triangulation of animal, bird, man, drawn through these kind of lines of flight, sex, cut. And it's this triangulation of the forces of a kind of prehistoric iteration of identity as a kind of moment of conceptualization. So the Birdman is one of only a few human figures in the cave of Lascaux. And it's a figure that already is embedded in an animal world. It's an identity scene that is constituted by non-human and inhuman elements. So it tells us something about the forces of the universe, the forces of life. But despite these kind of lack of relative human figures, the Lascaux paintings have become iconic in the articulation of the origins of subjectivity. And I think we're in a kind of parallel moment of thinking about the origins of a kind of Anthropocene subjectivity at the moment. But often these expressions are seen as this kind of moment of man in the kind of birth of a kind of cultural milieu coming out of the last ice age. So they're kind of, they're understood as part of the genealogy of European Homo sapiens in a kind of evolutionary understanding of how art becomes a way of, you know, often being articulated as mapping into a narrative of human development out of Africa is the kind of traditional sort of space in which these images are placed. That out of Africa has also been fragmenting recently, and now it's kind of mostly out of Africa, but there's actually with all these kind of new fossil finds, fossils actually disrupt genealogy all the time because they present new stories about new kind of migrations and geographies. So in the context of subjectivity, it might be asked, what does the earth of the cave, its geomorphology, play in bringing forth these images? The image depends on geology, on how minerals from the ground, animal bones, hold the paint, how the shifts from glacial to interglacial seal the cave to guarantee its endurance. And so that erupts in a moment, this, you know, the Lascaux cave was discovered in the midst of the extermination camps in Europe. So it presents this whole other figure of human life, of creativity in the midst of kind of some of the most extreme destruction in Europe. So it presents another story, another kind of origin story of human identity. And the second, what I kind of want to think about here is not this sort of notion of man touching rock, but actually rock touching the figure that is not man into being. Is it not the rock that lures the waiting imagination to find something that subtends it? If we remember the commonest form of rock art, which is the kind of open hand, the most kind of common human imprint, this is an open hand with ochre spat around it. And then we're remembering the first act of touching, the open hand, the spit, lip, and breath to the question of touching earth and its geologic perspective. Rock becomes body, body becomes bone, paint made from ground bones and animals become a present in a geologic now. So I want to shift to Australia now, to the second geologic subjects, who are the Guan Guan paintings, and they were a collection of paintings in the rocky outcrops of Kimberley, West Australia. And there's two distinct groups in this image-making area, the Guan Guan and the Wadjia face images, and they're often kind of called these ancient small people. So there's this kind of movement between small people and big people. But these images are kind of in this space of contested identity because the heritage is questioned. These images are located within native title claims, and they're being used to articulate contemporary debates about kind of racialized and genealogical disputes to land in that area. So they're deeply, again, embedded in questions of identity and belonging. But I think what is interesting about these images is how they mobilize a sense of the kind of virtuality of rock itself. How they actually speak to the movement of rock through the kind of movement of these images, that they draw out the kind of virtual qualities of rock. But they also summon forth a kind of actualization in the formation of subjectivity. But it's an actualization that is kind of involved in the geology, in human forces and non-human forces. And it confirms a certain affiliation to both self-witnessing, but also kind of witnessing through and within the earth. So they're kind of a gesture towards other dimensions of time. But what's interesting also about these rocks is that they're living paintings. So they're not just an engagement with inhuman forces, but they're an engagement with non-human forces. So the images are made up of bacteria who have sustained this relationship with the fungi, and normally bacteria and fungi would make a lichen, but they've resisted each other and continued over centuries to reproduce. So this is a very different idea of the kind of descent of man. So it's an image of a kind of humanoid figure, but it's the bacteria that's making identity. It's the bacteria that is reproducing over millennia to make the identity of these images. So it kind of brings forth a much more kind of dynamic ecology of the idea of human identity and who's involved in identity making of both non-human and inhuman forces. So in a sense, we might kind of see these images as a kind of experimentation with the new. And I think that's what the power of images can actually do, is kind of mobilize these different temporalities of life and to kind of connect to the virtual and the potentiality of other forces of the universe. So aesthetics are then connected to the virtual and its potentiality, and art allows us to kind of pass these spaces that life itself cannot pass. So it passes this limit that life, you know, within its bounds, its biological bounds, cannot itself pass. And I think this is why aesthetics has an untimely quality, because it draws into these regions of temporality and experience that are beyond yet also imminent within the present. So it converses with the mobilities of the rock itself, of geology. So we can see this as a mode of experimentation with Earth events, rock life, Earth revolutions, geomorphic shifts, and as a kind of space of communication with the interiority of inhuman forces that experiment with the cosmological and geologic life beyond life. And I think it's these experiments in aesthetics that actually provide a kind of speculative way to think about how we might begin to think our geologic life through kind of image-making practices. So if the Anthropocene is considered as a new epoch of thought, there's a need to think about what epochal thought should do. What capacities does it enable, recognize, and privilege in the making of a world and its materializations in images and thoughts? If we are to begin again as a geologic subject, the untimely quality of geomorphic aesthetics in the underground might be a good place to start. In terms of conceptualizing a new kind of political geology of the Anthropocene. And this is a kind of project of embodiment and ideation that is about making deep time sensible, about kind of beginning to understand how to feel and think with these deep time ecologies and forces of inhuman life. So we might think of the Earth as a kind of provocation for philosophy as much as philosophy itself. And I'm just going to leave you with that.
Okay. So thank you, Catherine, for taking us from cave art to the 3D Google glasses there. Our next speaker is coming actually from the opposite direction, from California. TJ Dimas recently became the professor of the history of art and culture at UC Santa Cruz, where he directs the new Center for Creative Ecologies, which studies the intersection of art, culture, and environment. He is author of The Migrant Image, The Art and Politics of Documentary During Global Crisis, which won the Frank Jewett Mather Award, a significant honor with local residents. Mather, as you all know, was here for many years and the director of the museum at which I work. More recently, he's completed Decolonizing Nature, Contemporary Art and Political Ecology, focusing on contemporary art's relation to the environmental crisis, as well as art against the Anthropocene, visual culture, and environment today. TJ, welcome.
And thank you also to Daniel for the invitation to speak here today. It's a privilege to be here. I'm excited to take part in this contribution to what we might think of as the emerging environmental arts and humanities. which is, I think, a really exciting and growing academic enterprise. And I really look forward to the other presentations today and tomorrow. It's a really exciting lineup of speakers. So in last December 2015, the UN Climate Change Conference, COP21, or the Conference of Parties, met in Paris to agree upon an international plan for addressing anthropogenic climate change. In its shadows gathered some 15,000 members of civil society, NGOs, environmental activists, artists, indigenous organizations, and multiple social movements, pledging to redirect the talks away from their corporate-dominated influence. This is just a diagram from a website that tracks corporate influence at COP21, just to give you a sense of all the fossil fuel corporations and energy interests that were behind this most recent meeting of the UN. Gives you an immediate critical approach to what the agreement could possibly amount to with these types of multinational corporations involved. So much of that corporate influence came directly from the fossil fuel industry, fossil fuel being a term that, not surprisingly, given the corporate pressure, never even made it into the final agreement, which, given its commitment to non-binding national contributions, non-binding being the key word here, to reduce greenhouse gas emissions, wasn't really worth the paper it was printed on, according to many critics. In this presentation, I'll offer first a brief overview and analysis of the activist practices that occurred in the shadows of COP21, and then I'll draw some conclusions from that discussion which relate to the underlying concerns of this conference. So I'd like to begin with a video. One contender for winning climate games, an action-adventure competition for the best artistic activist act of civil disobedience unleashed during COP21, was surely Operation Vivaldi by the Zoological Ensemble for the Liberation of Nature, their French acronym EZLN being a playful spin on the Spanish one for the Zapatista insurgency. Appropriately set to the canonical Four Seasons, the group invaded a Volkswagen dealership in Brussels. Its members, dressed as trees, monkeys, sheep, fruit, and vegetables, threw leaves in the air and placed monkey-wrenching banana skins under the car tires, creating a scene of wild abandon, generally wreaking havoc and targeting VW owing to recent scandalous revelations that its cars were systematically designed to cheat on emissions tests. The brief sortie ended by chanting the slogan, "We are nature defending itself," one of the key nature-allied and thus post-anthropocentric mottos of the climate games. Climate games, on whose website, which you see here, the EZLN filed their action report, is the creative work of the French-based laboratory of insurrectionary imagination. A rebellious popular theater, permaculture, and protest-directed collective with roots in the anti-globalization movement of the 1990s, when they organized their carnivalesque and anti-motorization campaign, and more recently in Climate Camp, their anti-airport, their participation in this anti-airport expansion movement, both in the UK. Their recent project, a sort of alternative Hunger Games, coordinated online that invites international participants to enact protest feats anywhere in the world, targeted UN climate negotiators for repeatedly failing to come up with a plan to address the environmental crisis, and instead caving to green capitalist interests. They were joined by simultaneous subversions in France's capital by a slew of NGOs, civil society reps, and indigenous activists. So I'd like to show you the brief trailer, the anonymous style trailer for Climate Games. It's just a couple minutes long.
This is the mesh. It is everywhere. Some say it can't be defeated. But what if we cracked it open? Would we be nature defending itself? Climate Games, the world's largest disobedient action-adventure game. In Paris, across cyberspace, and beyond. Your objective, to join the global movements, swarming to shift the game against profit, in favor of life. We are not fighting for nature. We are nature, defending itself.
Another worthy contestant in the Climate Games was the inflatable barricade. The blow-up blockade builds on strategies of popular insurrection going back to 19th century revolutionary France and has been recently reinvented by the group Tools for Action, a European collective based in Berlin that uses inflatables for protest purposes. The air-filled and fun-eliciting sculptures, or disobedient objects, according to Gavin Grindon, are ideal for disrupting police paranoia that sees protesters as violent criminals, injecting a childlike lightness and joy into civil disobedience events. The red lines on the giant silver balloon signify, according to widely publicized activist claims, the limits of minimal survivability on a livable planet. That is the right to soil, the right to water, the right to a just transition, as explained the Laboratory of Insurrectionary Imagination member John Jordan. In other words, lines that cannot be crossed if climate change agreements are to have any popular support or universal validity. The red lines, and here you see another photo of the inflatable barricades being put into use in front of the Eiffel Tower. Are significant because, as Naomi Klein recently noted, COP21 negotiations were currently on track to steamroll over them. These include equity red lines, meaning that wealthy industrialized countries that have been producing greenhouse gases for a couple hundred years must acknowledge their fair share of emissions reductions. And legal red lines, meaning that any climate deal must be legally binding. Both of which were subsequently ignored by UN delegates in the final Paris Agreement. As such, Climate Games and related COP21 activism challenged corporate-dominated climate governance and its free market and trade-friendly imperatives. These are viewed by opponents as amounting to so many misguided solutions, such as carbon capture, biotechnology, geoengineering, and financial incentives like cap and trade and debt for nature swaps, which instrumentalize environmental crisis as an engine of profit-seeking wealth accumulation. Meanwhile, over the last 20 years of COP meetings that have annually endorsed these sorts of policies, Greenhouse gas emissions have steadily risen, with 2015 now confirmed as the Earth's hottest year on record, following the previous record set for 2014. According to Pablo Salón, the former Bolivian climate negotiator, the Paris Agreement will see the planet burn. Indeed, for environmental studies scholar Brian Tokar, the national pledges in advance of COP21 have all been inadequate, forecasting a catastrophic future of 3.5 degrees Celsius or more, warning by 2100. And in the words of Pope Francis, author of the recent Catholic Call to Arms encyclical on the environment, he says, we are at the limits of suicide. Resonating with these dire assessments, projects like the inflatable barricade also tested the limits of civil society activism in the face of France's declared state of emergency following the recent Paris terrorist attacks. For protesters such as the Brandalism Collective, which has been playfully hacking billboard adverts across Paris to amplify calls for climate justice as part of their own contribution to climate games, the state's measure effectively de-democratized the UN meeting, isolating climate negotiations even further from civil society participation, a division fortified with a militarized police force. Their retort is that climate change is an even greater state of emergency, one that operates as a threat multiplier to all other crises, military, refugee, economic, and so on, as no less than the US Department of Defense recognizes. In this regard, the inflatable barricade's red lines also mark out a new form of artistic creativity joined with activist determination in an era of climate emergency. As an increasingly urgent form of environmentally engaged art, it moves away from the limited scale and locally defined artistic models of, say, eco-restorationism, whereby practitioners would dedicate themselves to repairing damaged habitats, rivers, and forests in past decades. In the 1970s and 80s, work, for example, of figures like Hans Hacke and Agnes Dennis and Mel Chin and Joseph Beuys and the Harrisons and Alan Sonfist. You can see examples of their work here. From today's perspective, it's akin to rearranging the deck chairs on the sinking Titanic. In other words, making local interventions no longer seem quite adequate, despite their good intentions, in addressing the now undeniable threat of climate breakdown that is insistently global in definition. In this regard, the ecology that desperately needs repair, even before the natural environment can be restored, is that of planetary governance itself, including its mesh of political, economic, and techno-scientific institutions. And that's precisely where current artist activists are directing their energies. An additional candidate for a Climate Games Award, even though unaffiliated with the project, would be the Natural History Museum, the work of the New York-based art collective Not an Alternative. Here you see an example from their website. Also bridging the divide between art and activism itself, an increasingly necessary emergency measure in today's climate catastrophe context, the project attempts to pressure arts, culture, and science museums across the US and internationally to reject fossil fuel-based corporate funding, whereby corporations obtain a social license to continue their activities. Not an Alternative also connects with groups like Liberate Tate in the UK, protesting BP's funding of institutions such as Tate Modern and Tate Britain. Calling attention to the fact that oil mogul David Koch sits on the board of the Smithsonian National Museum of Natural History in DC and has museum wings named after him, as in the Metropolitan Museum of Art in New York, Not an Alternative challenges this economics of corporate greenwashing, whereby climate change deniers and corporate carbon polluters like Koch, who has spent over $67 million since 1997 to fund groups denying climate change, can mobilize public institutions as vehicles for their own publicity. In March of 2015, the group organized an open letter to museums that you see here from their website, signed by nearly 150 scientists, including several Nobel Prize winners, calling on American museums. And it turns out there are more museums in the US than McDonald's and Starbucks combined, to cut all ties with the fossil fuel industry and funders of climate science obfuscation. As such, they're part of an increasingly global cultural divestment movement. In fact, Koch resigned from the board of New York's American Museum of Natural History in last month in January, after 23 years of membership. In Paris last December, the group linked with an international coalition of similar organizations, including the US-based Gulf, Occupy Museums, the UK's Art Not Oil, and BP or Not BP, Liberate Tate, Platform London, Shell Out Sounds, and UK Tar Sands Network, and an anti-oil drilling organization in Norway, to undertake an unauthorized divestment protest at the Louvre in Paris, an institution sponsored by Italian oil and gas corporation Eni and their French counterpart Total. Outside the museum's IM paid designed iconic glass pyramids on December 9th, performers carried black umbrellas spelling out the words fossil-free culture and spoke of their support for a culture beyond fossil fuels, both at the COP and in our museums. This again, would have been a protest that went against the France's state of emergency at the time that banned collective gatherings. According to Becca Ekonopoulos, who's a member of Not an Alternative, on the occasion of the UN Climate Summit in Paris, we are urging the Louvre to stop sponsoring climate chaos. At the same time, a smaller group created the scene of what appeared to be a small oil spill in the atrium of the museum, a glimpse of fossil fuel extraction's catastrophic uncontainability, and then proceeded to walk through it barefoot and then around in concentric circles, their footprints on the marble floor, visualizing the fossil fuel corporation's despoilment of the museum and more broadly our environment. A number of participants were arrested by the French police and held for a short period for the degradation of cultural property. But for writer and activist Yates McKee, affiliated with Gulf, standing for a global ultra-luxury faction based in New York, the police had apprehended the wrong suspects. The oil footprints marked the scene of a crime implicating the institution in the fossil fuel system and the climate crisis. What we witness with these models is a shift in artistic practice toward an expanded creativity directed at challenging the very structures of climate governance and global finance, as well as the political economy of cultural institutions. The goal is to reinvent democratic self-determination through direct action by contesting corporate power and its capitalist imperatives. In other words, these artist activists are opposing what they view as a petro-capitalist tyranny that decides how we address environmental crisis, which is now widely seen as a threat like no other, as complex and interconnected as it is singularly grave and consequential. The artistic element of these actions involves injecting playful theatricality, collaborative energy, and the spirit of positive fun, as well as the revelations and demands of an emergent eco-art institutional critique into what otherwise might be another dour mass protest march, which was at any rate prohibited in Paris for much of COP21. That said, the practitioners who've formed alliances with dozens of organizations internationally, as well as indigenous movements and governments of underdeveloped nations assembling in Paris during COP21, such as Coalition Climate 21, one of the many alliances of organizations. These practitioners have no naive expectation of immediate success. Rather, the struggle is admittedly long-term, though the stakes have an immediate urgency, and the motivations are multiple, to invent creative tactics that will, at the very least, symbolically pressure UN delegates to finalize a viable and socially just plan, and more ambitiously, to design creative models of activism that are nonviolent and capable of generating a collective source of infectious joy for participants in the invention of a new world and a decolonized future. That joy is particularly needed if we're to overcome the cynicism and depression that results from the international dependency on the failed solutions of the COP system. As the Louvre action, at the Louvre action, yet another red line was drawn before the umbrella-wielding protesters, as you see here. This one meant to catalyze solidarity with frontline indigenous communities fighting for climate justice. Daniel Tusselle from the Diné First Nation in Canada explained, in the Arctic, we're seeing severe impacts from global climate change. Simultaneously, we're defending our traditional homelands and culture from aggressive assaults on sacred and important subsistence use areas, such as the Arctic National Wildlife Refuge. How are we to survive if the fossil fuel industry, companies such as Eni and Total, continue to impede our rights? They're committing climate genocide on us. There's no way that we can allow corporations to continue to generate a social license to operate by sponsoring our cultural institutions such as the Louvre. Climate gains finally aim to create mediagenic operations in the public realm with representations, videos, and memes that can travel through social media and across alternate news outlets. Activist forms that are reproducible and distributable globally, connecting with educational and grassroots campaigns all over the world. Indeed, the reach of climate games was impressive. One LA-based group, the Gay Me Agenda, put together an interactive zine inspired by climate activism, while a German team called Something to Do with Polar Bears blocked a giant digger from operating in a lignite coal mine near Leipzig. Holding a banner with the message, Ende Gelände, or end of story, system change, not climate change. While a British group in London called Plain Stupid blocked a road to London's Heathrow Airport for several hours to disrupt the government's plans to expand the runways. And recently, participants were told by a court in West London to expect a prison term. They're soon to be sentenced. And the Curitiba group in Paraná, Brazil, joined the games by creating a series of reproducible speech bubbles with translations of We Are Nature Defending Itself, and organized the country's first People's Climate Assembly as a grassroots educational initiative. These and many more actions are listed on the Climate Games website, which is itself a kind of interesting and amazing new technology for networking disparate activists, organizations, and actions worldwide to create a convergence of effect on COP21. These measures provide ever visible and public evidence that the directions of the corporate-dominated negotiations are far from representative of the views of an increasingly vocal section of people and animals, as the EZLN would add, on planet Earth. We can only expect such creative activism to continue, and indeed there's upcoming activities planned for May by the group 350.org, which is one organization that is trying to bring a lot of these different participants together. So these activist artistic models offer a number of responses to the framing set of questions that have inspired this conference after the spectacular image, art, architecture, and the media of climate change, which I'd like to briefly discuss in my conclusion now. Spectacular images may be insufficient when representing the agglomerative slow processes of geological change and environmental violence, as we've already heard today, and as the work of Rob Nixon demonstrates. But they remain effective, that is, spectacular images remain effective, even strategic, when mounting political campaigns directed towards specific goals of liberating institutions from the petro-capitalist economy. Drawing on a long-established tradition of protest actions, but doing so in an increasingly media-dominated environment, activist artists are producing imagery, performances, and activities that are instrumental to that goal, rejecting the opaque, meditative, quietist, autonomous and private models of competing art forms, including the environmentally minded. It's true that, as the conference organizers write, the analysis of spectacular images has given way to an archaeology of the invisible and an attempt in both creative practice and scholarly analysis to reveal histories of the entanglement between social and natural processes. But in this case, the entanglement is one of political, economic, and natural cultural systems, where the archaeology of the invisible concerns the greenwashing of oil and gas sponsorship, revealing the economic influence playing out behind the beneficent facade of cultural institutions and the cynical interests of fossil fuel capitalism as unseen determinants behind a precarious public culture. It's also undeniable that images relate directly to our knowledge of climate systems. And in the case of COP21, the image was mobilized forcibly by governments and transnational organizations and corporations in order to project an illusion of effective and unified climate action that was immediately celebrated in the media, as if there is such a thing as global climate governance providing leadership in the address of environmental breakdown. At the same time, a massive contestation took place on the ground and within the realm of the image, amounting to a major conflict between the interests of green capitalism and its priorities of limitless growth, and popular demands for a transition toward decarbonization that takes into account the priorities of climate debt and social justice. Conference participants are asked, again, this is from the preparation for the conference, can we trace a historical shift from image to visualization, from representation to performance? How have such images impacted political and cultural debates about nature, environment, and the climate? As we've seen, there have been more than a shift from image to visualization and from representation to performance. As well, there has been a transition from conventional artistic categories and institutions to an expanded politicized creativity embedded in social movements within civil society, which has as its goal the liberation of institutions where they connect to climate action. This concerns not only art and cultural institutions like museums of natural history, but also the UN institution and its COP system, seem to be ineffective and discredited mechanisms of governance when it comes to addressing climate breakdown. In its place are demands for institutions delinked from neoliberal corporate influence and the construction of so-called people's institutions, which have currently been constructed as models for actual implementation, such as the International Tribunal for the Rights of Nature, which also met in Paris in the shadow of COP21 and practiced a modeling of politico-juridical processes that would hold corporations responsible for the crimes of what they call ecocide, offering a template for wide-scale adaptation. Finally, how do contemporary visual infrastructures condition and organize political and ethical action? What's become evident with COP21, which was certainly visible to critics beforehand, is that there is a fundamental conflict evident in the visual infrastructures that organize political and ethical action in relation to climate governance, a conflict between, one, the priorities of what I've been calling green capitalism, exemplified, for instance, in much Anthropocene discourse as well, which by and large tends to support the neoliberal governmentality of market mechanisms and techno fixes, such as geoengineering and financializing nature. That doesn't mean it can't also be productively troubled, as we've already heard by Catherine Yusoff just now. So that's one. And two is the demands of civil society that insist on addressing the environmental crisis by reorganizing the conditions of life according to the priorities of economic equality, social justice, human well-being, ecological biodiversity, and democratic practice. Climate games and related models offer examples then of how current practitioners are attempting to invent a new visual, media-based, and performative repertoire capable of organizing political and ethical action to that end. Thank you.
Thank you, TJ. In contrast to the first two speakers, our final speaker this evening presumably just had to hop on New Jersey Transit to get here. He is Reinhold Martin, associate professor, rather professor of architecture in the Graduate School of Architecture, Planning and Preservation at Columbia University, where he directs the PhD program, as well as the Temple Hoyne Buell Center for the Study of American Architecture. He is founding co-editor of the journal Gray Room and has published widely on the history and theory of modern and contemporary architecture. His work centers on histories of space, power, and the aesthetic imagination, particularly as mediated by technical infrastructures. He is currently working on two books, A History of the 19th Century American University as a Media Complex, and A Study of the Contemporary City at the Intersection of Aesthetics and Politics. Reinhold's paper is titled Risk, Excerpts from the Environmental Division of Labor.
Okay, well, it's late and I will try not to detain you for much longer. Anyway, Catherine's and TJ's talks were so interesting, I'd just rather honestly have a chance to speak with them and with you about what's already been discussed. But I do want to thank Dan for bringing us together here in a very, very interesting combination, I think has been noted, and also to Carl for your patience, I suppose, in trying to put two and two together. I'll begin by saying that what I have to offer today is actually adapted from teaching, not from scholarship per se. In other words, there's nothing original. And it's really, you know, a kind of effort to confront some of the dilemmas of teaching that, you know, particularly in a professional school, which is where I teach, but not just there. This is, I think, translates clearly to the humanities, where we teach both justice and injustice simultaneously. And we have to take seriously that fact around, the, you know, for example, the issues that we've been hearing about. I have tried in this brief excerpt to connect elements of the, in this case, of the post-war architectural canon. This could be done with many other things. This just happens to be what I have, with processes that are generally thought to lie outside of its domain. With climate change and its consequences really just kind of really very much in the background for most of the talk, both historically and in the contemporary world, though. And the kind of main thing is that solely through the visual output of architects and their colleagues, associates, and so on. So it's visual documents that are, in a sense, meant to be the glue that holds everything together performatively. Translated also out of architectural pedagogy into then a humanities setting like this, you could think of this as a kind of exercise in cognitive mapping, of putting things together that don't normally mix, even though everything I will say will be very obvious, to articulate the longstanding critique of capitalist globalization with the contradictions of what was called a long time ago species being. Now, as you no doubt know and would have inferred probably from my title, according to the late Ulrich Beck and following him many others, we live today in a risk society. 30 years ago, actually I think it was to the year, 30 years ago, Beck argued that as risk distribution overlaps with and ultimately merges with wealth distribution, a risk society overlaps with and ultimately replaces the class society engineered by industrial modernity. At which point modernity's instruments, this is the reflexive modernity thesis, modernity's instruments redeploy to distribute and manage risks, both real and imagined. A contemporary monument to this society nearby is the Bank of America Tower, or One Bryant Park in Midtown Manhattan, designed by Cook and Fox architects for the Durst Organization, real estate developers, and completed in 2010. You may know that this tower was the first commercial skyscraper to achieve LEED Platinum certification, LEED being Leadership in Energy and Environmental Design, certified by the US Green Building Council, which despite its official sounding name, is a private organization. Hundreds of pages of documentation were no doubt assembled to achieve this result. Among them was probably something like this. this is the generic version, a LEED pre-certification application for environmental air quality. On such pages, on such documents, which elsewhere in, on other pages would have reported, for example, the presence of a 4.6 megawatt cogeneration plant, not as big as Princeton's, by the way, you guys have a big one, a thermal ice storage system, fritted glass, and waterless urinals for the predominantly male bankers, that these documents would surely have included text documenting a MERV 15 air filtration system on all of the building's air handling units. MERV stands for minimum efficiency reporting value, and a MERV 15 rating, which is normally achieved with 12 to 36 inches of microfine fiberglass and removes 95% of all particulate matter from the air, including apparently all bacteria, is standard. This level is standard for hospital inpatient care, but not for office buildings. But it was included in for Bank of America. So in 1986, Beck defined risk as a, quote, systematic way of dealing with hazards and insecurities induced and introduced by modernization itself. Always present, these risks came to be widely recognized during the 1960s, well before anything like climate change had been verified. But even then, when puffing smokestacks still punctuated Western skylines and workers occasionally still went on strike, claiming those factories as their own, risk was not limited to the visible dangers of industrialism. Instead, says Beck, quote, the risks of civilization today typically escape perception and are localized in the sphere of physical and chemical formulas. This is a quote from Beck. So in keeping with this axiom, the risks managed by the Bank of America Tower are largely invisible. They are measured by physical and chemical formulas that describe the behavior of greenhouse gases, as well as by MERV ratings and the dimensions of fiberglass filters. In keeping with Beck's thesis, risk society and class society, I'm going to risk this, risk society and class society have indeed met in the particle-free air inside this building, I realize, of course, you can't see the titles on the, there's information about what you're actually looking at that you can't see, but anyway. which was filtered, the sort of particle-free air inside the building, which was filtered, heated, cooled, and lit, to support the activities inside. But when we look more closely, we do not see really one regime replacing the other. This is kind of the point, that even from the point of view of epochal thinking, that rather we see a striking interdependence. So One Bryant Park was designed as a speculative core and shell office building and was LEED rated prior to acquiring its main tenants, for whom the building's high environmental standards, as they said, were reportedly an important factor in securing tenancy. That's the Bank of America, who occupy 75% of the building's overall square footage, and about one-third of that comprises the bank's trading floors. So as a result, and despite the platinum rating, it has been reported to some kind of scandal that the building emits more greenhouse gases than any similarly sized tower in the city, largely due to the energy loads generated by the 24/7 activities of those floors, the trading floors, with their screens, servers, and sleep-deprived bankers. All of which is, of course, in support of the bank's ultimate purpose to manage and profit from financial risk. At One Bryant Park, it does so at fair expense to the external thermal environment, if this claim is actually true, but at relatively minimal environmental risk to the material comfort and well-being of bank employees, who breathe particle-free conditioned air as they speculate financially on the material risks taken by nations floating their currency or homeowners mortgaging their houses. Of special interest to us, then, is that the coincidence of these two forms of risk, environmental and financial, is underwritten by the invisible partition of what modernism used to call space and what we must now call air, and a corresponding division of labor. Now, that division, which is orchestrated above all by drawings and other visual documents, that's what I'm trying to, in a sense, show you, demonstrate here, the way that drawings orchestrate this kind of partition, that division of labor begins with the consultants. The firm E4 Inc., Green Building Consultants, who actually filed the documents and acquired the lead rating, probably filed the documents, and acquired the lead rating, was only one of the building's approximately two dozen authors. Along with the architects Cook and Fox and Adamson Associates, the list includes the MEP engineers Jarris, Baum and Bowles, JB&B, the environmental consultant Viridian Energy, the facade consultant Israel Berger, the geotechnical engineers, so geology, Muser Rutledge, and a whole host of others who say nothing of the hundreds working under the general contractor Tishman Construction, or those in the factories who produced its recyclable steel. The steel in the building is recyclable, so it anticipates its own obsolescence and repurposing, or the engineers and line workers at Carrier who designed, produced, and installed the air filters, and so on. Now, this, of course, is nothing new. This is just what you know about industrial production. But I want to emphasize the obvious, that the technical performance on which the building's LEED certification rests belongs to the same class-based, gendered, and racialized transnational division of labor that organizes the economic processes on which the Bank of America's traders speculate. So the issue is not that LEED certification uses spurious criteria, or you know, that in a sense it's as it were, technophilic. It is that in addition to attracting tenants, including in this case Al Gore, who was also in the building, that certification, LEED certification, and the documents that subtend it structurally bracket this other, more diffuse distribution of risk, precarity, and their material support. So this is now sort of the architectural history part. Here's an earlier and simpler architectural example that is not usually discussed in terms of environmental and climate issues, which also has to do with the management of light and air at a building's outer surface, though with a much different, much more visible sort of filter that you see here. This is a working drawing, for the brise-soleil or sunbreakers that Le Corbusier designed for the Secretariat building at Chandigarh, capital of the Punjab, and by the way, site of the modernist open hand, in 1952, sculpture. So here's a detail showing the play of light and shadow across that facade slash filter. And here then is the, so these are from the Corb archive. Here is the nearly all male, multicultural, though probably all English speaking and certainly all literate design team that executed those details. Here's the master plan of the city. And here is the design for a peon's house to be located at the very bottom of the plan here. This is biopolitics or species being. Here's an only slightly higher ranking house, an enclave designed by Jane Drew and Maxwell Fry for the government messengers, all male, by the way, and one of whom you can see riding a bicycle here in the photo, who move bureaucratic documents from office to office in the Secretariat building. And here is the Secretariat building under construction with its brise-soleil, this sort of modernist contribution to thinking the relationship to the sun. As shown in Le Corbusier's oeuvre complète or complete works. In his, and I owe this recognition to Vikramaditya Prakash in his essential account of Chandigarh's design and construction, Prakash calls our attention to the rural woman carrying bricks on her head in the foreground. And we can add and infer to what Prakash says about it, we can add that she most likely lives on site, that is, she doesn't live in a peon's house, and that her children or those of her extended family are most likely playing in the dirt just outside the frame. Most likely, too, she cannot read, much less interpret the technical drawings passing from the architect's office to the construction site. And so there's probably a string of supervisors and interpreters, all male, who translate the instructions written in English on the drawings that I showed you into oral instructions, probably shouted in Punjabi or Hindi or in a village dialect, that inform her what to do with the bricks. It's a kind of diagram of a division of labor. So if the Brie Soleil at Chandigarh belonged to a tradition that paid detailed attention to environmental matters, kind of in the background, we recognize this construction labor and the risks she bears, the many risks she bears, as a precursor to those who, wherever they are, fabricated and installed the filters separating the dust and bacteria from the Bank of America's air. Subordinate members of a class society, supposedly obsolete, on which the allegedly immaterial labor of bankers ultimately places its risky bets. So, class and caste base as it is, a city like Chandigarh and everything that it stands for accommodated, nevertheless, a relatively wide spectrum of modern subjects in its architecture and planning, from peons to members of parliament, even as it excluded others, like the manual construction laborers. LEED certification and associated regimes recalibrate life in the far less visible terms of gases emitted and particles filtered. By building in a rather more stark, if more geographically distributed and diffuse arrangement. In short, the partitioning of air here is far more absolute, socio-technologically speaking, than the partitioning of space visible in Chandigarh. At the Bank of America, either you are in or you are out. Financialization depends on such partitions, which are produced and repeated at countless scales. So how, then, did this happen? How did the socio-technical imagination by which we still gauge our modernity come to turn on a materially real division of air as well as of labor, and the increasingly stark filtering out of one world from another, a precarious world outside that assumes the risks and a securitized one inside that speculates on and profits from them? Now, of course, this question is far too vast and far too complex to address in a short presentation like this, or even in a kind of teaching setting. So in keeping with the conference focus on visualization, in this sort of second half of my talk, I'll only offer a quick summary of some very well-known architectural ways of drawing or visualizing and thereby partitioning air, followed by a slightly more detailed example that I think lies kind of in the deep background, the historical unconscious, probably, or maybe even conscious, of this and many other buildings, the Bank of America Tower, and its contradictions. I emphasize, therefore, that in no way is this a matter of aesthetics doing one thing and techniques doing another. Rather, it is a matter of filters of various kinds that quite literally draw air I need a filter through themselves and in the process it's too much time on planes too much divide draw air through themselves and in the process divide populations both in the imagination and on the ground. Here is probably the most canonical. In 1960, for example, Buckminster Fuller captured the cognitive landscape of environmental risk in his dramatic photo montage of a dome over Manhattan, which builds an image of inside and outside that anticipates the actual partition achieved by the Bank of America's particle filters. Manhattan is becoming, in effect, this at this point, certainly from a socioeconomic point of view. Inside is clean air, outside is polluted air. Inside the dome, one among innumerable inflatables projected and occasionally realized during this period, the pressurized conditioned air also acts as structural support. Fuller calculated that the dome's surface area would measure 1/85th of that of the buildings that it covers, thus reducing energy loads required to heat and cool that air to 1/85th of existing levels. Add to this François d'Allegret and Rainer Banham's notorious environment bubble, photo montage drawing of 1965, which juxtaposes the ludic psychosexual freedoms of a technologically mediated air-conditioned interior with an indeterminate and possibly hostile exterior. Mix these with Arkezoom's laconic diagrams for No Stop City, a paper project drawn with the aid of a typewriter, its subroutines transcribed into a repetitive algorithmic loop. Add then Super Studios, this is, you know, greatest hits. Super Studios Super Surface, which transcribes the statistical survival of the species into the repetitive flatness of a life without objects, as they called it, i.e. a life after consumerism, in, or rather on, a limitless, gridded technological desert rather than inside an environmental bubble. Finally, add Cedric Price's proposal for a fun palace in a working class neighborhood in London in the early 1960s. Instead of inflatables, a movable steel frame regulated by a cybernetic command and control system accommodates the indeterminate, unpredictable leisure activities of the residents of the neighborhood. How is it, though, that these residents had so much leisure time? Well, actually, they were unemployed. This is because this part of London was hit hard by deindustrialization and the consequent movement of jobs to less expensive locales that belong to the risk-reward calculus of creative destruction. Price's privately funded People's Palace offered fun as compensation. So a slightly less optimistic reading of this project. Anyway, it would seem, nevertheless, that risk brings rewards when it supposedly displaces class on modernity's battlefield. Production is exchanged for pleasure, work is exchanged for leisure, and the museum replaces the factory, most vividly, of course, in Piano and Rogers' Pompidou Center. Again, all you need to see here is the conditioned air. Rendered in this section as a neutral white set off against the improbably blue Parisian sky, awaiting one event after the other, one exhibition after the other, one film after the other, superimposed interchangeably in a string of serial pleasures without end. As Marx and Engels predicted, all that is solid does indeed seem to have melted into air, even as mass-produced structure is fetishized by architects in self-consciously technical drawings abstracted from the steel that they describe, to say nothing of the workers who made and assembled that steel, and so on. Nevertheless, architecture did actually continue to manage other risks belonging to the supposedly obsolete class society. In the construction industry, a changing division of labor, kind of basically diagrammed here, among architects, engineers, consultants, contractors, managers, builders, and workers, spanned the planet in a newly decolonizing or otherwise networked sphere. As the complexity of construction rapidly increased, and as its legal and financial regimes crossed many more borders, and as computerization took command, that industry, the construction industry, was increasingly awash in drawings, models, technical specifications, feasibility studies, legal documents, insurance applications, environmental impact reports, code reviews, client presentations, and other precursors to today's LEED certificates. So, in the midst of all this, the bank reemerged from the 19th century, along with the museum, as a paradigmatic type. Or really, even more than the purpose-built monument, the speculative office building that invariably houses a bank, or seems like it should, buildings like this, became paradigmatic with its sheer iterability, its systematic adherence to the socioeconomic norms that are now ratified by the LEED certification system and other correlate regimes. Since the 1960s, many monuments to banking and finance have forecast this normalization. So what I'm suggesting is this is the consequence of quite a long process of normalizing a certain kind of imaginary. It converges with a kind of environmentalist discourse. So many monuments to banking and finance have forecast this, this quiet establishment of platinum standards by which conformity to the neoliberal hegemony is enforced via what we must call a metaphysics of the Anthropocene. But none more so, and despite its theatricality, than Norman Foster's purpose-built headquarters building for the Hong Kong and Shanghai Bank, which was begun in 1979 and completed in 1985 in what was still then the British colony of Hong Kong. So here's a list of the consultants involved in the design and construction of the project, with offices in London, Hong Kong, St. Louis, Hamburg, and elsewhere. Managed by this network, the design of the building as an integrated system assembled from the many prefabricated parts likewise allowed these parts to be manufactured in disparate places and made both design and construction a sophisticated logistics problem. A very tight site favored prefabrication, as did the limited availability in Hong Kong of technically skilled construction workers. The visual description of the building as a system began with the client presentation with which Foster Associates won the commission. Annotated sketches became slightly less sketchy diagrams explaining how the kit of parts will work. It's a kind of environment machine, basically. I mean, that's what we look. In addition to breaking down a complex system in its constituent parts and corresponding division of labor, these drawings did the important work of verifying to bank executives that the overall system is just that, a system, in which technical variables like construction workers, consultants, office space, and conditioned air are input, and optimal solutions are output. Here are several models made during the early stages, a preliminary structural model, a site model, and a full-scale mock-up of the exposed cross-bracing being tested in Foster's office. After the design had gone through a number of revisions, Foster mustered all of the persuasive power of the sober axonometric drawing in a slide presentation of the intermediate scheme. These are the slides from the client presentation to the bank's board in a conference room in Hong Kong. A year later, the presentation of the final scheme was punctuated with a photorealistic montage, a model photograph cut into the Hong Kong skyline as seen from the bay, of the ultimate design. Behind this realism, however, are uncounted calculations and uncounted abstractions in correspondence with the project's division and distribution of labor, of responsibility, and of risk. The diagrams, details, charts, models, tests, specifications, and so on that circulated through overlapping channels occupied by architecture, engineering, construction, and finance. Optimizing for specific variables is the basis of risk assessment. And even when money circulated as mathematics, the sort of banking done by HSBC in the 1980s needed actually a vault. In Hong Kong, the vaults were to be on site and in the basement, which had to be excavated then from unstable soil near the city's waterfront without disturbing the foundations of neighboring buildings or settling to a degree that would introduce too much uncertainty into the calculations for the new building structural system. Hence, the architects, engineers, builders, insurers, and clients had to be absolutely sure that the excavated ground would only settle within tolerable limits. Now, of course, this is a common situation with large buildings, but here, given the site conditions and the requirements of the vault, the challenge was particularly acute, and here, too, we find the presence of a sort of geological space and time tracked in the technical drawings. The diagrams on the left, on your left, show the contours of the predicted settlement as well as those of the actual settlement as measured on site. Those on the right show the calculations made by Arup Associates to predict that settlement, as well as the actual measurements made on site during construction to verify the predictions. All of these architectural visualizations are made with mathematics, via an instrument field of comprising piezometers, inclinometers, and other sensors collecting data on site, and a large mainframe computer in Arup's office. Arup also used their mainframe computer to calculate the building's superstructure under both static and wind loads. So on the left is a structural model with about 3,200 nodes and 3,000 elements, in other words, very, very tiny by today's computational standards. The model was run through finite element analysis, as in the images on the right showing east-west and north-south wind deflection. So the weather. Calculations were also made to test the frame's ability to withstand what Arup's published description called a malicious event, meaning an explosion or a terrorist attack. In other words, calculated risk. Wind testing for the building was probably the most extensive ever done to this point by the mid-1980s. Data were gathered on wind direction and velocity in the Hong Kong area, which experiences typhoons on a regular basis. Wind profiles were drawn and topographic models were made, and you see one of them here, down there, for wind tunnel testing, and later prototype structural elements were constructed, like what you see here, and were themselves measured under projected wind loads. Both the structural frame and the cladding were modeled and tested against the different types of wind data. Here are two models related to the wind tunnel tests. On the left is a wind tunnel site model, and on the right is a surface pressure model in which were embedded 500 sensors to measure the peak external pressures and suctions on the surface of the building in the wind tunnel. It's a time. All right, we're done. We're almost done. The exterior wall components that had to withstand these loads were detailed by Couples Products in St. Louis. And so technical sketches like this one from Foster's office and design development studies like this one from Couples, as well as construction documents, specifications, and shop drawings had to travel or otherwise be translated from St. Louis to London to Hong Kong and back. As Hong Kong was still a British colony, most of the contractors working on the project were either British or French. So the likelihood that the documents in circulation were mostly annotated in English may not have met with too much difficulty. But it also registered another related hegemony. As at Chandigarh, it is equally certain that not every worker actually building the building and reading the drawings was able to read English. So at some point along the way, a translator was probably required. This was especially likely given the technical sophistication of the building to ensure that workers were obeying the drawings' thoroughly risk-managed commands to the letter. Meanwhile, back on the side of the highly regulated office interior environment, the Hamburg office of the Kirchborner team, a space planning firm, tabulated the results of a handwritten survey, again in English, among the future users of the building, and entered these into a computer to optimize interior fittings. The calculation of value was based not on generic norms, but on specific user priorities. Variables were input and optimal solutions were output. Foucault called this environmentality. This is a kind of behaviorism. To see them, you must be able to see then, in a drawing like this, all of the system's components assembled around a kind of absolute interior, a no-stop city or a continuous gridded supersurface into which could be plugged the results of user-generated surveys tabulated by space planning consultants half a world away. Here you also see the invisible air of capital, which has acquired distinct material properties of its own. If you look more closely, you can see the workers whose invisibility made that air possible and the financial calculations that paid for it. To be sure, as at the Bank of America Tower 25 years later, the stated aim of all of this was to maximize efficiency and flexibility. The actual result, however, was a new kind of security matched to the imagined and indeed economically performative financial security of the bank itself. This sense of security was not based on knowing that there was money in the basement vaults, although at this point it still was based in some sense on knowing that there was a vault. Rather, it was based on the probabilistic calculations of the risk-managed system swaying gently in the wind above. Today, in the lead platinum Bank of America Tower and many others like it, a corresponding environmental, financial, and socio-technical regime and an even more complete division of labor converts that wind into filtered air in order to manage and exploit the risks inherent to a system built from, on, and in it. Thanks.
Well, I could begin then by TJ asking a question of you.
Hello.
I noted in the Climate Games video that you played the sort of tagline for the games, which were, "We are not fighting for nature, we are nature defending itself," which I think could be read in perhaps a couple of ways, but in one sense serves as kind of a corrective to the reification of nature and the cordoning off of it that is such an artifact of anthropocentrism. And it insists instead on us as nature and thereby on the radical interdependence of things. And the structure of the games itself seem to sort of recapitulate that in their crowdsourced, kind of atomized way, much like in a way the climate marches across the world the year before and other climate actions. And I wondered, as we think about art after the spectacular image, if that might serve as a kind of metaphor for kinds of art and kinds of actions that might be especially useful in that they do, in some sense, mirror the interdependence of ecology and of nature. I wonder if you had a...
Sure, I would agree with that. That is, I think, that the point of that motto, we are nature defending ourselves, is a rejection, as you're pointing out, of human exceptionalism, basically. And I think that has become, in many ways, a pervasive kind of cultural understanding these days, that we have to reject that division between culture and nature. Many people have been doing this theoretically for a long time now. Artists are exploring the ramifications of this and what it might mean for addressing the current crisis in relationship to climate. I think, as Catherine pointed out, though, this goes back, this geologization of the human goes back thousands and thousands of years. So in a way, maybe we can look at the period of post-Enlightenment modernity as a very brief anomaly, one that insisted on or tried to develop that separation in relationship to very dangerous approaches to objectifying and financializing nature. But I think that this is very broad, and it's being developed in a lot of really interesting ways by diverse artistic practices these days.
Mm-hmm. Can I ask just a quick follow-on? Because what's interesting to me about those kinds of activism is the cordoning off of fossil fuels. So there's a kind of, we are nature, but fossil fuels are kind of on the outside of that kind of. So there isn't really a kind of, a kind of acceptance of the way in which fossil fuels are kind of very much part of who we are, that none of us would be if it wasn't for fossil fuels. So our kind of becoming is pretty, linked into that. That's a difficult negotiation because it sort of, it brings, it's we are nature, but we're not that. And that's a sort of rejection of a material formation that actually kind of precedes how we become.
Yeah, I think that's right. I think there's a more complex kind of partitioning or organization of nature that we might explore in challenging the potential simplification of that sentence, where nature defending itself, as if nature, even if it includes the human, is in a way intrinsically good or promoting biodiversity and excluding fossil fuel capitalism, when fossil fuel capitalism itself could be seen, as people write, for example, I'm thinking of Jason Moore and Andreas Malm and their theories of the capitalist scene as an alternative to the Anthropocene discourse, to see nature and capitalism as mutually imbricating all along through the development. So in that sense, fossil fuel is itself a part of that capitalized nature. So I think you don't have that conceptual complexity necessarily at the level of the strategic activist demands when it comes to that slogan, but I think it's worth exploring that and developing it more. Yeah.
Phil Donahue, I'm glad you brought up the capitalist thing, because I was worried about this tendency maybe that was developing of using the term Anthropocene maybe a bit uncritically and without the notion that this is a term that in many ways is a kind of rhetorical attenuation of human experience on the earth, right? And that there are sort of multiple divisions of ways in which people relate to nature and relate to production and consumption and things like that. And I wondered if maybe all of you could perhaps speak to this issue a bit. I remain uneasy with the term Anthropocene, not only for those reasons, but there are ways in which it can also be read as a kind of triumph of humanism in a different kind of sense. Humans have finally arrived at the center of the story of the history of the world, you know, because we're actually anthropogenically modifying climate, you know, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So I wonder if you could talk about kind of why might we be uneasy with the term, you know.
Skepticism and even opposition to the Anthropocene discourse. I think a number of people are mobilizing it in very interesting and creative and helpful ways. But I think ultimately we might pause, and I would encourage us to pause and question whether we want to even adopt this term or go along with its adoption. I don't think we have to. I have a short book coming out called Against the Anthropocene. It's kind of a polemical text. That explores why we should reject this term, or on what basis we should, you know, mobilize resistance to it. Because I think if you look at if you analyze the ideological effects of Anthropocene discourse, it leads right into a kind of techno-utopianism organized around geoengineering projects as the central way to address climate change, and it loses all political traction. I think that the fact that people like Stuart Brand and others that go back to 60s. Techno-utopianism is indicative of where this is coming from and where it leads, despite a number of really great readings of Anthropocene discourse that are also out there. But I think someone like Jason Moore, as well as Donna Haraway, proposed a number of alternate phrasings of what
the Thulucene.
Yeah, the Thulucene and the Plantationocene or the Nomocene. There's a number of competing terms out there that are really useful and worthwhile thinking through in lending some greater critical traction against the Anthropocene.
Did you
want to
say something?
Yeah. I mean, it's a deeply ambiguous term, and there's a kind of, on one hand, you want to do the critique of that, and there's some very easy ways you can kind of critique the Anthropocene, and just the fact that it's called the Anthropocene, it's the Anthropos, and so on, and this kind of recentering on. But there's also kind of a promise of a kind of rematerialization of certain kind of material flows within a kind of within social life that have been kind of absent, which I think is really useful to look at. And also, one of the things that I've been doing recently is just trying to think towards a black Anthropocene. So actually all the moments of kind of the origination, origin stories of the Anthropocene, whether it's the long Anthropocene or the kind of the, you know, Capitalocene kind of moment, or you can read, you know, foundation to all of those is race. In the production of those moments. So I think it's kind of, you know, there's a need to kind of think about these kind of, where are the sites and subjects of struggle within the kind of making of the Anthropocene. And, you know, it's a bad word, but it's a bad word that kind of introduces some things that perhaps have been a little kind of on the kind of sidelines of our thinking about these relations. So. Yeah, it's kind of a password to something, but it's already within a lexicon that can take it in very unhelpful ways. I mean, that's what's interesting about the sort of that fossil fuels on the outside is the same kind of, you know, some Paul Crutzen and so on talk about nature as us, but they use it to talk about we are now a nature superpower. And therefore, geoengineering, and it's like this kind of, you know, that sort of, unless you kind of bring fossil fuels onto the inside as a kind of intimate genealogy, then I think the sort of specificity of the Anthropocene gets somewhat lost.
I'll answer also a little bit in the spirit of the pedagogical spirit I was trying to evoke. In the actual class from which some of this is excerpted, I end the last one is about the problem of the Anthropocene and the line. Because if you ask, what is this thing? It's a line, basically. It's a really, I can show you, you know, we could show how it's a series of different lines that have been drawn and redrawn over and over again in papers in Nature and in other scientific venues, and then eventually popularized, become TED Talks, etc. So over a hockey stick graph, all that. So what, you know, so it actually, if we want to think critically about this, I think, you know, one way to do it is to think critically about a linear notion of history or a teleological one, which is kind of the basis of this type of critique. But there I would, you know, at the same time, you want to, the alternative for the most part, I don't know. I mean, I don't have a working inventory of all the possible scenes that are out there. Probably there are some that are better than others. But, you know, the ones that substitute one metaphysical category for anthropo gets substitute capital, the same thing. In other words, that, you know, the socialists were really all about electrification. And says, you know, so, you know, Lenin's light is, there's a beautiful thing called Lenin's light I learned in Mongolia, electrification. And so, you know, alternative economic, political economic structures have also contributed a great deal to this. But I would just add one more then thing. So at least it derails the idea to think critically about the linearity of this kind of historicism. You know, it poses the question about what really would constitute a break, and how do you know? Because, you know, notoriously, the problem with paradigm shifts is that you can't tell when you're in one because you're using the old tools. So we should be suspicious that our historicism is misleading us to some extent, and then certainly our teleological notions of history, including deep history and all that. But on that, I did want to sort of, let's say, dissent a little bit on the nature question. Because I have to say, I don't consider myself nature in a kind of ontological sense. I certainly appreciate and recognize the importance. I think not an alternative, by the way, has been doing great work, and you know that they cut coke off of there was fantastic. And you know, the kind of, in a sense, the performative value and in a sense strategic use of certain kinds of expression, but you know what I would actually probably want to say about this thing that we're talking about is that it's closer to what is in some discourses is called the real. Like, in other words, I don't know. I just on the train I was looking at some interesting traces of the real. Did you see that they listened? They were able to listen to black holes today. I mean, this is an amazing thing. Now, is that nature? Sure, but only when we discursively, you know, assimilate this noise, background noise, the background noise of the real, into our scientific and technical and technocultural imaginations, our discourse, our terminology, our calculations, and so on, does it become nature, right? So, you know, it seems to me otherwise what we're talking about is just like what is real. And so, you know, we could say the same as I was trying to insinuate about air. But so I, you know, again, I think we maybe epistemologically want to differentiate, you know, kind of specify or differentiate the categories a little bit in order to know when we're using things strategically or, you know, in a sort of like direct speech type way, activist sense or other, and when we're really trying to be, in some sense, to tell the truth.
Okay. Thank you. It was a very interesting panel for me because it also perfectly visualized the kinds of elephants in the room that always appear when people talk about the Anthropocene, when scholars talk about the Anthropocene. It was a very interesting different set of different discourses around your three presentations with regard to the position of the human and the human scholar. And this is what I want to ask about. And when, for example, when we mobilize phrases such as I'd like, no, we should reject human exceptionalism. Who is the we that is doing the rejecting? And isn't that very gesture of performing this rejection already a certain reaffirmation of human exceptionalism? I'm not asking it from the position of trying to defend exceptionalism. I'm just wondering whether the very performance of the gesture of rejecting it isn't itself counterproductive, because it can only be done from the position through which you have to affirm a certain gesture of being able to do that in the language, in the set of philosophical discourses, in the set of kind of logical pronouncements that you have to claim for yourself as human. And in that sense, the kind of suspending of the possibility of extending that we are nature, that is also the part of the same logic, kind of extending the human, now kind of reaching out. And that also kind of returns me to the question of the human scholar who wants to study the Anthropocene and, for example, or decides not to study the Anthropocene, writes against it. But in that sense, that is still a return to a certain kind of modernist human, if you like, who's gone through the Anthropocene critique and taken on board all the things that are happening, but is to some extent perhaps unable to turn the mirror back on him or herself and ask these questions about the delimiting of the philosophical human that is being that is appearing in that very gesture of either rejecting the concept we're dealing with or coming up with alternatives. So that's the kind of question about the philosophical foundations of the very discourses we're playing with.
So that's for everyone, really.
Okay, so I think I would agree, but you know, at the same time, there are many things to be defended about Enlightenment philosophy. One of which is it puts us in a position to establish some kind of critical discourse on what's happening. In other words, it's in its own consequences. In effect, if we, you know, recognize, of course, that all of this is more or less coterminal. So, I don't think that we need to throw it out the window in try to invent, as it were, a philosophical language ex nihilo, adequate to what we perceive to be our new historical situation, or somebody else's new historical situation, to take your point about the we, right? Somebody else who may or may not be human or even be a being in some, you know, stable sense. I suppose the what looks like is happening, I just sort of saying this, thinking out loud, that what looks like is that the temptations of metaphysics that come with words like nature and so on are reasserting themselves. And one thing that at least I feel that I've learned for some time, including in this room, I have to say, a long time ago, about the, as it were, challenges posed by Enlightenment, is to be somewhat, including it as a metaphysical category, the human, humanism, etc., is to at least bear a certain productive distance from the efforts to ontologize and to sort of reground in what usually turns out to be a cosmo-theological way, being. Right. So no Heidegger for me in this case. It would be a different philosophical tradition that would be more, it would really be Nietzsche, and what Nietzsche does with animals rather than what Heidegger does with being, where I would begin, but that's a longer and more complicated discussion.
I would agree with Reinhold that we have a critical language and we can't simply just abandon it completely, even if it puts us in the position of being aware of certain contradictions in our speech, as you're pointing to. There was another phrase with the climate mobilization, which was, we are the people we've been waiting for. What does that mean? I think it's exactly the kind of performative effect that you're talking about. It's a strategic politicization of subjectivity that rejects, in some ways, a kind of apolitical posthumanism, whatever that would be, or a multi-species being, or an object-oriented ontology that removes us from any kind of political traction. And I think that that's crucial. So when I said we have to, or when I use the certain forms of the imperative in relationship to to activism. It's something that I would embrace. I think we need to do that. We, whatever that is, while we also acknowledge the fact that that, you know, it's a calling into being of those of us who want to join in the struggle, which I think needs to happen. It's a performative act of activism, and I think if we abandon that for certain kinds of conceptual abstraction or philosophical self-problematization or collective problematization, we risk abandoning the momentum of the struggle, which I'm interested in at least exploring and seeing how, you know, what it means when they say, when one says we are nature defending itself. I would not agree with Reinhold's remark that he is post-natural. This is a whole other, or non-natural.
It's not natural.
Non-natural. I mean, for me, it raises another larger conceptual and theoretical question between people, certain eco-critics like Tim Morton, who wants to develop a post-natural language, and activists who are returning to the natural in a central way that resonates very much with, for example, indigenous discourse and indigenous activism. I think I'm not convinced that we should abandon the concept of nature, even though I agree that we have to reject its conventional elaboration, as we're all familiar with. I think we need to reinvent it, and I think that that's what, in many ways, indigenous cosmopolitics allows us to do if we investigate that further and see where it correlates with certain political struggles internationally and between radically different kinds of conceptions of what nature is. I think, lastly, Eduardo Vigueros de Castro has really interesting suggestions about what a multinaturalism could be, and that helps to pluralize and also disarticulate that problematic notion of nature. But there's tons more to be said there.
One more quick question. I think, for me, the tension around the phrase, we are nature defending itself, conceals another kind of tension, which I think could be made more productive and more interesting. So we are nature defending itself implies that we are nature defending itself against not itself. But the internal logic of the phrase is that we are nature defending itself against itself, because there's no way of knowing what's nature and what isn't. So it raises this metaphysical question that we've kind of been going in circles around. But there's another kind of tension between the stuff that's been coming up, which is that it's a slogan that eco-artists have come up with because they want to do something with an urgency. There's an urgency around climate change and everything that has to be done right now, immediately. And on the other hand, the Anthropocene discourse also has this other side, which came up more in Catherine's paper, of this sense of deep time, where we're kind of reflecting on the origins of human expression with the Paleolithic cave art, and also potentially the end of human expression, not just the end of the Capitalocene, but maybe the extinction of humanity, maybe, you know, the covering over of everything that we know. And there's a tension between those two, because when you bring them together, there's a possibility that one can explode the other. You know, the deep time takes away from the urgency, or the urgency takes away from that kind of deep reflective current. And I'm not sure how to keep that tension productive and how best to make use of it. And that's my question. Is it worth pursuing those two very different timescales in a way that can get us out of some of this metaphysical morass that we could otherwise get into?
I mean, I don't think they're so far apart as perhaps, you know, I mean, so I've been looking at cave art alongside mining and fracking and all sorts of other kind of subterranean activities, and it's actually, that's part about around trying to think about these passages through the geologic. And I don't think of one as kind of this long, deep sort of, you know, horizon that goes off, you know, kind of, and we sit and contemplate. And the other is this kind of, you know, environmental issue that needs to be kind of addressed in a very kind of immediate sense. But they're both immediate in a kind of, in a configuration around geology, around a kind of that sort of question that I think that you were kind of bringing up around kind of a sort of sensibility, insensibility, and inside, outside of, and the divisions of labor that happen in those, you know, the bacteria and the fungi, that's a division of labor in keeping the red paint and the black paint going, and they're kind of, you know, that's alive, and that's now, and that's kind of producing this image of identity. So I think, I mean, certainly what I've been trying to do is just sort of, in some ways, kind of queer some of these origin stories a bit more, so that we actually, the origin stories that we have are already stranger and actually more interesting than we perhaps give them credit for in our sort of attempt to have this sort of teleological narrative. So sort of questioning some of these sort of anthropogenesis, but all sorts of genesis that are going on in these kind of moments of geologic touching.
I know what you mean about the tension there, I think, between a kind of emergency temporality that is very presentist and the long, deep geological history. And maybe there can be some conflict there, especially particularly within our, you know, within an activist approach to attempting to struggle for some kind of immediate address of this climate crisis. But I think ultimately, as we've seen, I think with that deeper geological history, if anything, helps equip us for to be able to address the conflicts of the present, including the history of modernity. And I think historicization is really at stake in a number of approaches to the Anthropocene or the Capitalocene, and that's really interesting to become aware of, and it really deepens the discourse. I think it really substantiates some of these questions and draws it back historically. That's really useful. So I think we're capable of doing both ultimately, of thinking with the urgency of the fact that we have limited time and we have to do something. There's I think we can do that while at the same time, you know, keeping the exploration of historical awareness of geological time open. So I think it's possible. There may be tension, but it's possible to think in many ways here.
You're right. Are we done now? Okay. It's tempting to go on, but just to try to add one more elephant to the room. It seems to me that in the COP case, it may be also be true in some of the examples, Catherine, that you mentioned, that the phantom, one of the absolute phantoms, the corporate monsters kind of gathered around, you know, surrounding the thing, and then the artist activists sort of in a way confronting them. But the phantom is the state, because there is, again, a different scale, a different historical scale, as well as a form of human association than the kind of immediate issue-based type interventions and the kind of more systemic corporate ones. I think it is possible and necessary to have a secular discussion about what constitutes the state today under these conditions. In other words, and what ought to constitute something like a state today, or whatever it comes after it, whatever other political forms come after it. So that as a kind of like instrument to, you know, because of course isn't the implication, and who, you know, and that's who's being addressed ultimately by the actions, is that the state is responsible, at least that's the form that we have, to mitigate or respond collectively, both internally and in concert with other states, to this catastrophe. Certainly not going to solve the problem, but it's one of the implications, I think, of interventions in the public sphere of the sort that you're referring to. And then there's the in a sense more philosophical questions related to the Enlightenment one, of the relation on the one hand between the state and the polity, and in a sense the state as a representative body, as something that, as it were, carries out the work of mimesis and in a very classical humanist way. Or whether that too could be queered, it could be transformed, it could be, in some sense, re-articulated into, I I'm always sort of wanting to cite Donna Haraway, since she's has been cited into what could be called a socialist feminism or something like that. So, in that case, and then, together with that, again, these are all historical questions that feather and interact with philosophical ones. The category of the nation as the filter through which we understand race historically. That we moderns, but also the way in which modern knowledge invented basically the category of race. And Foucault shows this very well in the work on society, in order to, in a sense, defend the species being of a certain body that called itself a society. So the nation-state articulation is in some sense, it's like a piece of infrastructure. Cognitive infrastructure, as well as institutional and territorial and economic and all the rest of it, that ought, I think, not to be abandoned. It ought to be, they first of all need to be delinked, and the category of the nation needs to be, it seems like it's speaking from a different class or a different, conference if we talk about these issues, but that's in some sense the point, that that needs to be subject to even more urgently to critique than it has been under, from the lens of postcolonial studies and so on. But the state, as a secular form of association, maybe is not something to give up on quite yet, it seems to me. That would be a different conference again, like the state and climate change. But that, I think, is what the implication is of the diagrams that show corporate hegemony and sovereignty in place of like a UN or something like that. So, end of speech.
As always, we're just getting going. Right. And we can continue the discussion outside with some wine and cheese and other things. And hopefully, again, tomorrow morning we'll be starting at 9:30. Breakfast at 8:30. Please join us. Thank you all for coming. Thank you.